So what I'm speaking about are these Goodstein sequences. Now, who is Goodstein? That's a drawing which I made from a photo of Goodstein. So a famous logician who was working in UK, I think. And he proved an interesting result about the relationship between finite numbers and infinite numbers. And that is what I speak about today. So we fix a natural number k at least as big as 2. And then we represent numbers m, which are bigger than 0. In a unique way, we use the exponential function and then division with remainder. So for every m bigger than 0, there exist unique numbers p, q, and r, such that first of all, I sandwich m between k to the r and k to the r plus 1. And then I do division with remainder with respect to k to the r. So m is k to the r times p plus q. The side conditions are then p is less than k and q is smaller than k to the r. And that's a number theoretic fact. Now, in this case, I call this m k normal form. So this representation is a k normal form of m. Now, if I have a k normal form of m, I can define a base change operation. So I take number m and I define what is the base change, replacing base k by k plus 1. So what is the idea? The idea is I look at this representation of m, and m is written with respect to base k. So let's put this k in blue. K is the base. And for short, I abbreviate this by m prime. And what is this? This is defined by recursion. Namely, if m is 0, then I do nothing. Otherwise, I replace k by k plus 1. So I replace k by k plus 1. And then I take this number to the r, where I replace k by k plus 1 times p plus q, where also replace k by k plus 1. And this is if m is in k normal form, k to the r times p plus q. Now, what does this do? It makes the number m usually bigger. Now I write down a sequence. So I take your favorite number m, and then I take m0 is m, and ml plus 1 is defined in terms of ml. So if ml is 0, then ml plus 1 stays 0. And otherwise, ml plus ml is different from 0. Then I take ml. Now I do a base change. I replace base 2, base L plus 2 in the L plus 2 normal form of M, L, by L plus 3, make the number bigger, and then I subtract the 1. So normally, ML plus 1 will be bigger than M of L. Now, if you implement this, this will produce a sequence which grows quickly, very fast, very quickly growing. And if you plug it into a computer will claim that this is a diverging sequence. But the theorem of Goodstein is now that it's a true statement that for every m, there will be an L such that m of L hits 0. That's a famous Goodstein result. And second, Kirby and Paris have shown that Peano's metic does not prove this assertion. For every M, there exists an L such that ML is equal to zero. So this is by Paris and Kirby. And this belongs to the most elementary independence results for first order Peano's metic. Now, the question is how to prove this result. Well, the proof. Let me just prove the truth of the termination of Goodstein sequences. So we define a function C K of natural numbers N, the natural numbers N, into the ordinals less than epsilon zero. And the definition goes as follows. C K of M is what? If M is zero, then I do nothing, I produce zero. And if M has K normal form, K to the R times P plus Q, I take here, I replace K by omega, then I have CK of R times P plus CK of Q. Now you can think, what is this function doing? Well, there are certain properties. We have, first of all, if you have the base change operation, if M is smaller than N, then for every base change, we have that M prime is smaller than N prime. This has a certain consequence, namely if M is in K normal form, K to the R times P plus Q, then M prime is a K plus one normal form, K plus one to the R prime times P plus Q prime. Third property is if M is smaller than N, then the ordinal interpretation, CK of M, is producing ordinal, which is smaller than CK of N. All these properties are easy to prove, just elementary verification. And the fourth property is, and this depends on the second property, namely, if I do base change in M. So I replace an M base K by K plus one, and I replace K plus one by omega. That's the same as replacing K directly by omega. But for proving four, I need property two, and property two depends on property one. So property four is not completely trivial, but as soon as we have established this, then it's easy. So assume that the Lth member of the Goodstein sequence is not yet zero. Then we do what? Well, we let O of ML, we take the ordinal associated to the Lth member in the Goodstein process, O of ML is psi L plus two of ML. If ML is not yet zero, then what? O of M L plus one will be psi L plus three of ML plus one. Now look, what is the definition of ML plus one? It is psi L plus three, and then we have ML, we replace L plus two by L plus three, we subtract to one. Now this number here is one less than the number where I don't subtract to one. So this is smaller than psi L plus three of ML, where I replace L plus two by L plus three, but not subtracting one. Now we have the situation that we have ML, we replace base L plus two by L plus three, and then L plus three by omega. So this is the same by property four here. It's the same as psi L plus two of M, which is O of ML. So what we see here is if the Goodstein sequence never hits zero, then we get the descending sequence of ordinals. OML plus one is always smaller than O of ML. So we start with OM of zero. Then this, next step is we go to OM1, OM2, and then we get a strictly decreasing sequence. That's very nice. And this proves termination of the Goodstein sequence. Now we have a nice picture. We have a direct limit presentation. Namely, what is the direct limit presentation? We have the situation base is equal to k. We have base is equal to k plus one. And we have the base replaced by omega. We have here the numbers. And now assume that here I have a number m, and here I have a number n. And assume that n is smaller than m. And after base change, the numbers will be increased, but the less n relation will be preserved. And finally, we move these numbers with the psi function into the infinite. And we get here ck of m, ck of n. And when you look into the picture, it is so that here are all finite segments, but in the limit, we get here an infinite segment. But the idea is once you're on the right track, you have these passes and they form a sort of directed system. And in this sense, one can see this these numbers less than epsilon zero as emerging from finite numbers. And these functorial aspects of this Goodstein process have recently been studied by different authors, among which are Anton Freund, Juan Pablo Aguilera, Michael Ratjen, and myself. So we have a recent preprint on archive about this, and if somebody's interested, he or she is invited to look into this. Now, in the talk, in the title, I claimed that we study naturality properties of systems for natural numbers. Now I want to go into this business, namely, what has this to do with natural well orderings? So what is natural in the representation of these natural numbers? So for this, I study terms, term systems, formal terms, for exponential functions, exponential expressions. So zero and one are terms. And if I have three terms, s, t, and u, then I form the formal term x to the s times t plus u in the formal term. And then I can show proposition, an easy proposition, for every numbers m and k, k is assumed to be at least as big as two, m bigger than zero. There exists a canonical term t depending on m and k, such that if I take t, m, k, and I replace the variable x by k, I get back number m. Now that's not so spectacular, but the point is, I want to have canonical terms. And the idea is if m is in k normal form, k to the r times p plus q, then t of m and k is x. And here I take the term for natural number r. And here I have term for q. So I just replace number k by variable x. Now, why is this interesting? Well, it has an interesting property. It's the following. So assume I have another term, t, such that if I replace x by k, and I take the value of this number, so I take the interpretation in the standard system. So if I evaluate this term, when I replace variable x by k, then I get number n. Then the canonical term has the following property. Well, if I replace in base k, in the standard k normal form, k by k plus one, the same as I take the canonical term for m, I replace variable x by k plus one. And this is at least as big as I take now the arbitrary term t and I replace x by k plus one. So what does this mean? This means that among all representations of number m, canonical term produces the maximal possible value. So all other representations of m get a smaller value. And I interpret this as follows, namely, it has to do with a sort of power of the notations. So we know epsilon zero is the maximal closure ordinal of the set singleton zero under a monotone increasing binary operation, binary function. This is, by the way, a famous result by Dick de Jong. And in some sense, it has been folklore, but it's somehow only recently available in the literature. But this is a very deep result. And actually, de Jong and Parekh were proving the most important results on Bell partial orders and ordinals. And this is one of the results. And this, the realization of the maximum order type is given by the function alpha beta goes to omega to the alpha plus beta. Now, these normal form representations also produce somehow maximal power. Now, the question is, what can you do with it? Now, the point is, we get the following extension of Goodstein's result. Let S be an association selection function assigning pairs of natural numbers terms with the property that SMK, where I replace variable x by k, is equal to m. So what does S do? S is selection functional assigning terms to numbers such that the value of the term where I replace variable x by k, we use the number m. Fix such a selection function. Now define a modified Goodstein sequence, namely at step zero, start with m. And if one has defined MLS, then one defines the next step in the Goodstein sequence. Again, we take zero if we have started with zero. And otherwise, we now take what? We take our selection function, apply it to the previously obtained value, and we replace base two by base L plus two by L plus three, and we subtract to one. If MLS is different from zero. So we have now, we are not working with the standard Goodstein sequence, but we work with the selection functional defining modified Goodstein sequence. The theorem is now for all L we have, the standard Goodstein sequence ML, the Lth member, is at least as big as MLS. So what does this mean? For all we have if you consider the length of the standard Gaussian sequence, the least L such that ML is zero is at least as big as the least L such that MLS hits zero. So this means for all selection functionals, the Gaussian sequence defined by the K-normal form is as long as possible, And that's somehow interesting. So now how can this be proved? By using the monotonicity property of what I just explained before. So I can give the proof. So M, we assume that this, this number is what? It's MLS. We have here L plus two and replace base L plus two by L plus three. Now by our monotonicity property, I can replace an arbitrary term by the canonical term for MSL. And I prove this property here by induction on L. So here I can assume that MSL is less than equal to ML. And now look, here we have the canonical term for the representation of ML after base change. So this is the same as ML, L plus two is replaced by L plus three, minus one, and this is ML plus one. So we see here that this number is less than or equal to this number. So this is a strong generalization of the standard Gaussian sequence. Now we come to the next property of natural notations. Namely, we show that the normal form has minimal length. So we speak about norm minimality. What does this mean? Well, I have to define what a norm is. The norm of terms is norm of zero is zero. The norm of term one is one. And the norm of term x to the s times t plus u is, and here I take one plus complexity of s times the complexity of t plus the complexity of u. Now, what is the motivation for this? Well, from coming from ordinals, I have a definition of a norm for ordinals. And if I plug in for x omega, then this norm function is the norm of the corresponding ordinal. But this norm function here is just defined as a term complexity function on my term system. Now, what is the proposition here? Assume that I have a number m represented by an arbitrary term t. Then what can be said? The norm of the canonical term for representing M will always be less than or equal to the norm of T. So what does this mean? The K-normal form produces terms of a minimal complexity. So we have normal forms have minimal complexity. And actually this is related to a number theoretic question, and I'm in contact with Harry Altman from Michigan University, and he has worked on what is called integer complexity, and he tried to explore what this says about these numbers. To interconnect these notations on natural numbers with ordinal notations, well, if I consider epsilon zero normal forms, well, I have a notation system, and in the notation system, I consider terms in normal form. I have all the terms which are not in normal form. What does this mean? Basically, this means I can contract subterms. So I have these laws where certain terms are eaten up. Normal forms are also the shortest representations of ordinals. So there's a certain analogy, and this is what I want to stress. So far, so good. So that's part one of my talk, the classical basis of a good scheme. And now I come to extensions. And for this, I study fast-growing functions, f alpha, from natural numbers to natural numbers. And if one has not seen the fast-growing functions, consider just alpha as a finite number. This will be sufficient for most purposes. So I study certain extensions of the standard Ackermann function. So f0 of m is the successor function. If I have a successor ordinal, I just take the function f alpha, which is previously defined, iterated m plus one times, applied to m. So this upper index is the number of function iterations, iterated applications of f alpha to itself. And if lambda is a limit ordinal, then I take the diagonal function. So I assume that lambda is the supremum of a fundamental sequence lambda x, x in n. So I assume that lambda is a countable ordinal. And I assume that for every limit ordinal which I consider, I have a canonical way of assigning a fundamental sequence. And then I take the diagonal function along this fundamental sequence. And typical examples are, if I have the fundamental sequence for omega to the alpha plus one, it will be omega to the alpha times m. If I have an ordinal of the form omega to the lambda, then it's defined by continuity. And if I have a term, a Cantor normal form of the form sum, I want to have, this is also defined by continuity. These are typical examples. Now we fix a proof theoretic ordinal.
Sorry, I didn't understand the limit case. Can you
yes.
Again? So you've taken an enumeration of the ordinals less than lambda?
No. So let's say I have the ordinals less than epsilon zero, and then I have the, let's say, the limits. Then for every limit ordinal, I assign a canonical fundamental sequence. For example, if I have the ordinal of the form omega to the alpha plus one, the mth member of the fundamental sequence for this number is omega to the alpha times n. These numbers, if m goes to infinity, converge canonically to this number. If lambda is a limit ordinal for which I have a canonical sequence lambda m, then the sequence for omega to the lambda is defined by, I take omega and then I take the mth member of the fundamental sequence for lambda. And if lambda m converges to lambda, then omega to the lambda m converges to omega to the lambda.
Okay, so we identify ordinals with their fundamental sequences and you plug the input m and you find the mth element of the fundamental sequence.
Yeah, somehow, so to say. I assume this law here that every limit is obtained by a fundamental sequence. So I just define this function here by recursion on the index. But just to understand it, it suffices also just to think about finite numbers. So if you don't know what ordinals are, that's fine. If I go a bit beyond omega, it's also fine. And you have omega to the omega, then you get these iterated Ackermann functions, and this is also fine. And if the ordinals are less than epsilon zero, and there's the standard fast-growing functions. And now I make a bold construction, namely I fix just an arbitrary proof of the ordinal pi. For example, epsilon zero or omega to the omega. with associated fundamental sequences. But pi can also be bigger than epsilon zero. Now I define canonical k-normal forms for natural numbers. So given a number m at least as big as zero, define k-normal form of m with respect to these fast-growing hierarchies along this number pi. Well, the first thing is, of course, if m is less than or equal to k, then m is in k-normal form. Now assume that m is bigger than k. Now choose first ordinal alpha zero, then pi, the maximal, such that f alpha zero of k is less than or equal to m. So approximate m from below, but with a maximal index. Now the next step is choose number b zero, maximal, such that f alpha zero, b zero times iterated applied to k is less than or equal to m. Now there are two cases. Either I have reached m, then this is a normal form. Otherwise, we have that this number here is still smaller than m. Then I do a next iteration. Then we choose alpha one less than alpha zero, where if alpha one produces approximation, so f alpha one of the previously defined value is still less than equal to m, and then I choose b one, so alpha one b maximum, right? So approximate as good as I can the numbers from below, and choose b one maximum, such that I have f alpha one b one, f alpha zero b zero. Less than equal to m. I use k. And I can iterate. And after finitely many steps, arrive at the representation of the form f alpha n bn f alpha zero b zero of k hits m. Finally, we hit m. And that's my base K representation. And actually, this the first version where this appears has been devised by Toshi Arai in his recent proof theory book. And now with Toshi and with Sten Wehner and David van Zwicker, we were using these normal forms to prove Goodstein results. Now, what is the base change operation for these numbers? Well, define the following base change operation. Well, if m is smaller than k, we do nothing. If m is equal to k, then I move k to k plus one, that's fine. And now assume finally that this we have this normal form. Then what we do is we take f, and then we do base change in alpha, alpha n, bn, alpha zero, b zero. I replace k by k plus one. Now I have to define what does it mean to do base change in ordinals. Alpha is a Cantor normal form omega to the beta times p plus gamma. Then base change is defined by I do base change in beta, in p, and in gamma. And I define so base change for numbers simultaneously with base changes in the ordinal. And then I have this number well defined. M is above. Okay, so we have these Gaussian sequences, and then we can define.
Sorry, yes. Can you say what happens if alpha is equal to beta?
That's a good question. So here I assume this is for alpha smaller than epsilon zero. Then we have unique normal forms. Otherwise, I have to go into unique representations. So when alpha is equal to beta, then alpha is represented by a larger ordinal function. And then I have to define Bayes' chains in this setting, which can be done, but I don't want to be too explicit right now. Now, if I have defined the Bayes' change operation, I can define the numbers ML as before. M0 is M and ML plus one. As I take ML, replace L plus two by L plus three and subtract to one. Uh-huh. Now, oops. Now, what can be proved? Following theorem can be proved. Namely, assume we have proves the on pi is omega. Then we can show PA. RT is zero. Does not prove for every M the existence L such that ML hits zero. So this construction of normal forms produces an independent result for RT is zero. The next theorem is if pi is equal to epsilon zero, then ID1 does not prove for every M existence L such that ML hits zero. The next theorem is we go for pi a bit higher. We take the ordinal of the proof theorem. It proves the ordinal of ID1, and then we get here ID2 does not prove for every M the existence L such that ML hits zero. And then it goes further and further. Namely, if pi is the ordinal of ID less than ID omega, which is pi one comprehension plus pi induction, then we have what is called a theory ID less than star. Does not prove for every M the existence L such that M is zero. And it goes higher and higher. If pi has a specific form, namely in the notation system with collapsing functions, if one has the capital omega function is the Aleph function. So we have an Aleph index, Aleph index, Aleph. Finally, I have an Aleph. Replaced by Aleph zero, then PA plus transfer induction along initial segments of the ordinal, where I replace the last small omega by capital omega, does not prove for every M the existence L such that ML hits zero. So I get quite uniform treatment of Gaussian sequences for very strong theories. And what is all behind this is a shadow of what is called the hierarchy comparison theorem. Between the slowing, fast growing hierarchies. Namely, the transition from this ordinal to this ordinal has to do with this hierarchy comparison. It's also the same here. ID1 and ID2 are related by the hierarchy comparison. Epsilon 0 and ID1 are related by the hierarchy comparison. And here we see RTA0. RTA0 has to do with gamma 0. But if P is equal to omega, we have the Ackermann function. So the Ackermann function relates to gamma 0 with the hierarchy comparison theorem. So this fits somehow nicely. Now, what are the problems? There are problems left, namely, Namely, we have these normal forms, problems about normal forms. What about base change maximality? And the last, normal forms don't have this property. What about norm minimality? The last normal forms don't have this property. So it's an interesting question to figure out, when do we have base change maximality, when do we have norm minimality? What happens if we modify the definition of base change? So can we devise intermediate Goodstein principles? And the answer is yes. So intermediate Goodstein principles show up when you do not base change at every position, but only at a selected smaller subset. What about systems of natural fundamental sequences? And it turns out that Goodstein sequences define some natural fundamental sequences, namely the stepping down in the Goodstein sequence. If you replace it by stepping down in ordinals, you have stepping down along a canonical fundamental sequences. It can be related to terminal writing. You can devise terminal writing systems for evaluating these normal forms, and you can define Goodstein principles in terms of rewriting systems. That's fine. We have the implications to the hierarchy comparison. Well, this is unreadable. And actually, what I find interesting is we have the num forms, the natural normal forms. And they induce direct limits. And now the interesting question is, given a system, a natural system of normal forms, in which sense do you get natural ordinal representations? And I believe that you can devise a nice normal forms of natural numbers such that the standard ordinal functions come up with this. And what's very interesting here is typically, if you have a number f represented as f alpha d of k, and if one has ordinals alpha less than epsilon zero, then normally you go to chi of m will be of the form. You have the psi function, psi function, omega 2 psi k of alpha times psi k of b. If one has natural numbers, norm forms here, then it turns out that the corresponding representations here will have normal form representations with respect to the Buchholz normal form. So it's all very nice. And this is part of an ongoing project. Many things are just open here. Normality is very open, but base change maximality is basically known. Now I see my time is more or less over, so I think I will stop here. So I have a solution for base change maximality. One has to replace normal form by a new normal form, a new sandwiching procedure, which is a bit more complicated, and this can be done. But I want to stop here. And at the end, I want to show you a nice picture just for the record. So you see a direct limit presentation of a flower, and that's it.